Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Transpacific Experiment, How China and California Collaborate and Compete for Our Future, by Matt Sheehan, read by P.J. Ochlan.
Sai Wong Shi Ma, Yan Zhi Fei Fu.
The old frontiersman lost his horse. How to know it's not a blessing. Chinese proverb. Introduction. Welcome to the Transpacific Experiment. Nestled against the western shores of the San Francisco Bay, Angel Island is both a monument to the past and a window into the future of the world's two most powerful countries. On the northeast corner of the island lies the immigration station, a relic of the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882. That act of Congress was the capstone to the first era of major face-to-face engagement between Chinese and American people. California was the stage on which these two groups made their first introductions and impressions. They didn't exactly hit it off. After the discovery of gold in 1849, tens of thousands of Chinese men made landfall in San Francisco, a city they called Gold Mountain. Fleeing famine at home and dreaming of rivers running with precious metals, these men left their villages in southern China and clambered onto wooden ships that would carry them across the Pacific. In California, they dug for nuggets, cooked for cash, and earned a reputation as cheap but extremely valuable laborers. When Leland Stanford and his fellow robber barons set out to build the western segment of the Transcontinental Railroad, they enlisted Chinese workers for the most crucial and the most dangerous tasks. But these men entered an America rife with economic anxiety and racial resentment. To Irish laborers in San Francisco, men like my great-great-grandfather, these Chinese arrivals were seen as a threat to their jobs and an affront to their identity. Newspapers and dime novels spread fears of a yellow peril descending on American shores. Demagogues thrived, blaming the new Chinese arrivals when banking crises dragged down the American economy. Thugs carried out lynchings at Chinese labor camps, and California's own governor demanded that Congress check this tide of Asiatic immigration. Those clamoring for a law excluding Chinese laborers sparred with men like Wang Qinfu, a naturalized American citizen who became one of the most outspoken defenders of Chinese rights. As residents of the United States, we claim a common manhood with all other nationalities, Wang wrote in 1893, and believe we should have that manhood recognized according to the principles of common humanity and American freedom. But those principled appeals largely fell on deaf ears among white immigrants resentful of the new competition. My own great-great-grandfather arrived in San Francisco in the 1870s, working at the Pacific Rolling Mill and living in a tough part of town known as Irish Hill. Our family doesn't have any record of him participating in anti-Chinese activity, but he certainly fit the demographic profile. A working-class Irish Catholic immigrant laborer scratching to carve out his space in a new city and country. His son and my great-grandfather, Tommy Sheehan, was born in San Francisco in 1879, 3 years before the Chinese Exclusion Act became law. Orphaned at a young age, Tommy grew up in St. Vincent's Home for Boys and went on to become a San Francisco longshoreman and union organizer. In that role, he befriended Peter C. York, a priest and vocal advocate for Irish laborers. Tommy used to drive York around the city on weekends, smoking cigarettes and talking shop. In our family, York is remembered as a righteous defender of the working man, but he did not extend that empathy to Chinese laborers. Keynoting the 1901 California Chinese Exclusion Convention, York railed against Chinese people who remained in the country during the exclusion era. We are face to face with an immigration which is emphatically not Christian, York told the crowd. Their thoughts are not our thoughts. Their blood is not our blood. Their outlook is not our outlook. 4 years after that speech, construction began on the Angel Island Immigration Station, where thousands of Chinese people looking to make a home in California would be held. One of the few exceptions in the Chinese Exclusion Act allowed for children and spouses of Chinese people in America to follow their relatives over. The immigration station hosted interrogations designed to separate out true blood relatives from paper sons, people who would claim a false familial relation in order to enter the country. Immigration officials would have new arrivals draw their family trees and maps of their home villages. Virtually all Chinese laborers in the U.S. were recruited from just a handful of counties in the south of China near Hong Kong, allowing immigration officials to cross-reference these diagrams with those drawn by earlier immigrants, attempting to weed out the paper sons in the process. Detentions could go on for weeks or even months. Some were finally granted entry to the country, others were sent back across the Pacific. Thousands of miles from home, but barred from San Francisco's shores, the Chinese prisoners carved poems into the wooden walls of the immigration station, engravings that you can still see there today. America has power, but not justice. In prison, we were victimized as if we were guilty. Given no opportunity to explain, it was really brutal. I bow my head in reflection, but there is nothing I can do. The Transpacific Panorama. Today, Angel Island offers a panoramic view of a new Transpacific reality, one being forged by the new era of large-scale face-to-face engagement between Chinese and American people. The surrounding landscape is where the world's two superpowers are getting reacquainted with one another at ground level in the 21st century. For a window into that process at work, we just need to take a short walk south from the immigration station. Exiting through the front door of the building, hang a right and head south along the island's paths for about a mile. Reaching the shore, scramble out to Point Blunt at the southeast corner of the island. These boulders offer up a sweeping view of the Bay Area. Berkeley and Ochlan to the east, Treasure Island in the middle of the bay, and San Francisco to the west. If the fog hasn't rolled in, you can just barely catch glimpses of Silicon Valley in the distance to the south. Starting in the east, you can see the Campanile, a Gothic clock tower at the center of University of California, Berkeley. Over the last decade, the number of Chinese undergrads at UC Berkeley has multiplied by a factor of 10, a microcosm of a nationwide boom in Chinese enrollment on U.S. campuses. In the aftermath of the financial crisis, public universities that saw their funding slashed at home turned to China, hoping that an influx of international undergrads paying higher tuition could fill the gaping holes in university budgets. Many Americans saw an additional benefit to the new arrivals: a chance to show the light to China's next generation, exposing them to free speech and planting the seeds of China's own democratic reforms. But things haven't exactly gone as planned. When confronted by the political evangelism of their American peers, many Chinese students feel increasingly confident in, or defensive about, their home country. It's a group that isn't necessarily buying into American political values. And the sheer number of new arrivals has stirred anxiety among some California students and parents, who fear that admission to America's top public universities is being auctioned to the highest bidder. That backlash is now going national, with members of the Trump administration accusing these undergrads of spying for their home country and proposing a total ban on Chinese students. Panning east to west across the Bay Bridge, you catch sight of the two largest housing developments in the region, both of which needed funding from Chinese investors to get off the ground. Past the cranes of the Ochlan shipyards lies Brooklyn Basin, a 2,300-unit development going up just past Jack London Square. And across the water in San Francisco's Bayview Hunters Point neighborhood, Chinese immigrant investors have poured hundreds of millions of dollars into the San Francisco shipyard, the city's largest housing and retail development in decades. That development rubs up against San Francisco's only remaining predominantly black neighborhood, the last island of affordability in a city that has seen a massive exodus of African Americans amid tech-fueled gentrification. As Chinese money comes in and the buildings go up, longtime residents look on with hope for new jobs and fear of displacement. Gazing south towards Silicon Valley, you can see the home of America's most influential industry, a thriving technology ecosystem that some fear will be disrupted by competition from across the Pacific. Chinese billionaires, coders, and internet juggernauts have arrived in Silicon Valley seeking out unicorn startups, top U.S. researchers, and the next big idea. Local startups have learned to pitch to Chinese investors, while in my hometown of Palo Alto, Mark Zuckerberg has devoted himself to studying Chinese. But when the giants of Silicon Valley return the visit in Beijing, they receive a much cooler reception. Google, Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, Instagram, and many more pillars of the global internet are outright blocked by China's Great Firewall. Still, entranced by the potential of a billion new customers, these companies are bending over backward to curry favor with the Chinese Communist Party leadership and its censors. Facebook has worked on software tools that would seal off Chinese users from political content abroad, and Google has offered to build a fully censored search app for China to regain access to its market. A decade ago, techno-utopians gleefully predicted that a free internet would be the midwife to democracy in China. Today, the question isn't how Silicon Valley will change China. It's how China is changing Silicon Valley and the very structure of the global internet. 450 miles farther south, the same dynamics are playing out in the other great bastion of American cultural dominance, Hollywood. For years, Hollywood films dominated Chinese screens and the people's popular imagination. But today, a booming Chinese box office, strict government controls, and the rise of Chinese-made blockbusters are eating away at Hollywood's hegemony. Like their peers in Silicon Valley, Hollywood studios are now rewriting plot lines to please government censors, all in a bid for greater market access. And as China's film industry comes into its own, American films are increasingly forced to compete with Chinese movies that marry Hollywood techniques to local sensibilities, creating China's own equivalents of nationalistic blockbusters like Rambo 2 and Captain America. Finally, complete the panorama from Angel Island by scanning the horizon on all sides, from the brightly painted hilltops of San Francisco to the mansions of Silicon Valley and the Spanish-style homes lining the East Bay. These housing markets have already seen dizzying price hikes from an influx of Silicon Valley tech money, and in the last 5 years, wealthy Chinese home buyers have pushed prices up even higher. Political and economic turbulence in China has led many of the country's wealthiest citizens to seek financial security in international real estate, turning multi-million dollar U.S. homes into the new Swiss bank account. The phenomenon of wealthy Chinese homebuyers touches not just on real estate prices, but also on social values. California today prides itself on embracing immigrants from all over the world, but that embrace has become more complicated when the new arrivals are wealthier than the longtime residents. It's challenging many Californians to ask themselves, do we welcome all immigrants, or just those of the poor, tired, huddled masses variety? As this new generation of Chinese immigrants sets down roots, they're now shaking up long-standing political coalitions. Earlier generations of working-class Chinese immigrants had become staunch Democrats, often building pan-ethnic coalitions and struggling alongside Black and Latino activists in campaigns for civil rights and racial justice. But the new immigrants are leaving China and entering America under far different circumstances. Instead of earning minimum wage at jobs in Chinatown, they often have high-paying tech and investing jobs in wealthy suburbs. For this cohort, affirmative action has become a lightning rod issue, catalyzing a new generation of Chinese-American activists that coalesced around an unlikely champion, Donald Trump. Now they are fanning out across city councils and serving as foot soldiers in a new wave of conservative Chinese-American politics. The phenomena glimpsed in this panorama are playing out to different degrees in cities and towns all across America. They are bringing the U.S.-China relationship down from the realm of geopolitics and directly into the lives of ordinary Americans. In doing so, they're shifting key dimensions of the relationship from the White House to the State House and from the Politburo to the PTA meeting. To see where the world's two most powerful countries are meeting, cooperating, and competing today, we need to get out of Washington, D.C. and Beijing. Welcome to the Transpacific Experiment. What is the Transpacific Experiment? The Transpacific Experiment is the living laboratory for a new breed of grassroots superpower diplomacy. It is the fluid ecosystem of students, entrepreneurs, investors, immigrants, and ideas bouncing back and forth between the Golden State and the Middle Kingdom. It's the Chinese undergrads expanding their horizons on California campuses, and the Silicon Valley startups scratching for a toehold in China. The California mayors courting Chinese factory investment, and the Chinese governors studying California carbon markets. As the top destination for Chinese investors, students, tourists, technologists, filmmakers, and homebuyers, California is ground zero for this experiment in deep and multifaceted engagement between China and the United States. The results of this experiment, the personal ties, economic frictions, and technological innovations, are already reshaping China and the United States and filtering out into the international system that orbits around them. All of these interactions bring new opportunities for investment, jobs, tuition dollars, and fascinating cultural fusion, but also new anxieties. When international diplomacy enters our everyday lives, it is transformed. Greater contact can humanize the other side, turning a faceless other into a neighbor, classmate, or even friend. But that close-up contact can also drag things in the other direction, sharpening awareness of our differences and making geopolitical problems feel personal. In the Trans-Pacific Experiment, we see both of these forces at work. A magnetic pull toward greater integration and synergy, as well as an intense backlash when one side feels manipulated or taken advantage of. Here we catch a glimpse of the tension that animates this experiment in grassroots diplomacy. This new breed of deep U.S.-China engagement has the potential to bring tremendous benefit to people in both countries. But in that process, it creates entirely new problems that hit closer to home. Heightening the drama is the grand geopolitical backdrop to these interactions. In the century and a half since Chinese and American people first came face-to-face in California, the relative positions of the two countries have changed dramatically. During that first wave of engagement in the 1800s, China was a once great dynastic empire slowly being torn apart by colonial aggression and internal strife. The United States was instead an up-and-coming nation of immigrants, an unproven democratic experiment mixing lofty ideals, messy realities, and mounting military strength. Today, the people of these countries are getting reacquainted on different footing, as citizens of the world's two superpowers. Now, the United States plays the role of the incumbent juggernaut. It is home to powerful global industries and proud national traditions, but also an increasingly fraught economic, social, and political order. And China is now the up-and-comer, a nation that has emerged from decades of domestic turmoil to challenge the United States for global leadership. To complicate matters further, China has not risen to this position by walking the path prescribed for it by Western theorists: free markets, free speech, and democratic politics. Instead, it has relied on its own unique alchemy of Leninist politics, state-guided development, and strict controls on speech and culture. That geopolitical role reversal infuses every aspect of the Trans-Pacific experiment. New ties may be forged at the grassroots, but they are often colored by our sense of relative standing on the world stage. How Americans feel about their new Chinese neighbors is intimately wrapped up in our feelings about China as a rising power, as well as insecurities about the trajectory of our own national experiment in democracy. Chinese people's perceptions of these interactions are similarly bound up in questions of national pride and insecurity. On a good day, the United States and its top companies might be looked at with admiration as a source of inspiration for artists, entrepreneurs, and educators. On a bad day, that same country is seen as mired in steep and unsalvageable decline, an aging nation that will expend its last ounce of energy attempting to hold China down. As Chinese investors, immigrants, and ideas make their presence felt on U.S. soil, they pose a question that challenges something deep within the American psyche. Are Americans ready for a world in which they engage with Chinese people, companies, and ideas on equal footing? Or a world in which the Chinese side has the upper hand? Today, California is the space in which these tensions, frictions, and possible futures are taking shape. In many ways, China and California make for an odd couple. America's most liberal state and one of the world's most sophisticated authoritarian regimes. A bastion of environmental protectionism and an industrial behemoth that leads the world in carbon emissions. The free-spirited home of everything from the hippies to the Kardashians, and an ancient Confucian culture built on ritual and personal restraint. And yet, those apparent contradictions are often what have drawn these two states into their dialectical dance. Chinese leaders see a vision for their own country's future in California. Blue skies, top universities, innovative technology, and global blockbusters. They know that if China is going to make the leap from a middle to a high-income country, it needs to move up the global value chain, fostering technological and cultural industries. In that light, California offers both inspiration and a tremendous wealth of resources to be accessed or acquired. For Chinese families, the stakes are less grandiose but no less important. They want clean air for their lungs, a good education for their kids, and a place to stash their life savings that is safe from the vagaries of the Chinese political system. They often don't think of themselves as volunteer diplomats in the most pivotal international relationship of the 21st century, and yet circumstance and happenstance have made it so. On the U.S. side of the equation, these same phenomena have a tendency to challenge dearly held values and pose uncomfortable questions about our own nation. At the neighborhood level, the new Chinese arrivals are turning many American ideas about immigration on their head, confronting Californians with complicated questions about acceptance, assimilation, and citizenship. Residents of suburbs like my hometown often feel comfortable, even self-righteous, in their open-armed embrace of immigrants and refugees targeted by President Trump. They abhor build-the-wall chants and proudly decorate their lawns with signs declaring, "No human is illegal." Looking back on the Chinese exclusion era, they condemn the racist white workers who resented Chinese laborers for stealing their jobs. But tweak a few of the variables and bring these issues to their own doorstep, and you might get far different reactions from these same people. What if the immigrant isn't a poor laborer, but a rich family escaping the Beijing smog? What if the resource being competed for isn't a working-class job, but a house in your hometown? What if, like many of the early immigrant laborers, the new arrivals have no intention to remain in the country long-term? Suddenly, that comfortable moral clarity is harder to come by, forcing a closer examination of exactly what principles to hold on to and which to amend. For California's trademark industries, technology, and culture, the rise of competitive Chinese ecosystems also challenges long-standing orthodoxy about the sources of innovation and creativity. For over half a century, California has been a global haven for personal freedoms and alternative lifestyles. During that same period, it has also dominated the world of technology and culture. That correlation between personal freedoms, technological innovation, and cultural production led many to believe these phenomena were inextricably woven together. A country without political freedoms could not truly innovate, and people without freedom of expression couldn't create a thriving cultural industry. It's a mantra woven deep into our American psyche, and one that seemed to be confirmed by the country's successive triumphs over rivals such as the Soviet Union. But the rise of China's technology and movie industries is steadily peeling apart that once solid correlation. In the process, it is challenging certain core beliefs about what makes innovation and creativity possible. Instead of putting stock in abstract personal freedoms, China is instead betting that you can build these industries up brick by brick. Throw together a critical mass of computer programmers, free-flowing capital, film sets, movie screens, and disposable income, and hope that innovation and commercial culture emerge from it. The game is far from over in these industries, but China has consistently outperformed expectations, and that surprising run of success is changing the conversation about technology and culture on both sides of the Pacific. Looked at from a 40,000-foot perspective, these issues can appear abstract or distant from everyday life. But all of these open questions and thorny problems are playing out in real time. They are affecting lives and livelihoods today, driven forward by real people with big ambitions, fears, and hopes for what the Trans-Pacific Experiment will mean to them. Over the past 6 years, I've used my own work as a journalist, analyst, consultant, and general hanger-on in California and China to follow these people's stories and fit together the pieces of this puzzle as best I can. The book you're now hearing is the result of that piecing together. It's an imperfect, incomplete, and subjective snapshot of these phenomena. In the process of writing, the people, places, and questions dissected here became a part of my life. Much of the writing here reflects that closeness, with both the insight and the bias that closeness brings. Bridging two distinct countries and cultures is a delicate and often fraught process. If done right, it can open entirely new vistas for the people and the places involved. If done wrong, it can turn minor frictions into a major backlash, fueling mutual suspicion and outright resentment along national, cultural, and personal lines. This book tells the stories of people who have tried and sometimes failed to build those bridges between China and California. But before telling you their stories, I'll briefly share my own. Over the last 5 years, the Trans-Pacific Experiment has exerted a similar pull on me, part personal, part professional, and a whole lot of dumb luck. That run of luck began with a broken ankle and a visa problem. Ankles and opportunities. I grew up in the Bay Area, but before 2008, had virtually no interest in China. My high school didn't offer Mandarin courses, and even if it had, I would have stuck with Spanish. In our survey courses on world history, we blew through a dozen Chinese dynasties in a couple of weeks. By the time I got to college, I could sum up my knowledge of modern China in three phrases: Mao Zedong, Tiananmen Square, and Factory of the World. But in the summer after my sophomore year in college, I stumbled into a job as a counselor at an academic summer camp in Beijing. It was June 2008, and the city was ramping up to host the Summer Olympics, furiously repaving roads and launching campaigns to discourage spitting in public. Despite those efforts, Beijing was still a city with an untamed heart. I found myself fascinated by the high-functioning chaos that reigned all around me. The lawless fluidity on the roads, the bruising bartering in the markets, and the no-holds-barred competition for every seat on the subway. Underneath that gruff exterior, there was also real warmth and openness toward Americans. Many working-class Chinese people had never interacted with an American before, and a big smile combined with some creative sign language went a long way in the cause of grassroots diplomacy. I made friends with the security guards at our dormitories, gifting them my frisbee on my last day there, and receiving one of their Beijing public security uniforms in return. Sitting in the airport lounge waiting for my flight to San Francisco, I knew I had to come back to China. So, after graduating college in 2010, I found a job teaching English in the central Chinese city of Xi'an. As I slowly gained Chinese language skills, that city and the whole country became even more captivating than on my first trip. After a year in Xi'an, I headed back to Beijing to study language full-time at a university. Graduating from that program, I began a job at a local TV station that broadcast English-language pseudo-propaganda about China in countries like Iran. By the spring of 2013, I knew that I wanted to work as a proper journalist. Reading American media coverage of the country, I felt that it wasn't capturing what I saw in the daily life of my Chinese friends. I wanted to fill that gap with their stories. I gave myself 6 months and $5,000 in savings to try to string freelance writing gigs into a job as a China correspondent. I hitchhiked across central China looking for stories, writing about a fight I witnessed at an airport and about the personal evolution of Chinese students who returned from studying in the U.S. When I eventually ran out of time and money, I had collected a handful of publications, but no job offers. Resigned to reality, I began interviewing for more mundane careers, selling real estate in central China or working for the U.S. Chamber of Commerce in the country's northeast. And then, a miracle happened. I badly mangled my ankle during a game of Ultimate Frisbee in Beijing. By the time I dragged myself into the lobby of a local hospital, my ankle was the size of a cantaloupe, but the doctor who glanced at my x-rays declared it to be no problem. If I stayed off it for a week or two, all would be back to normal. A few days later, I flew home to California for a long-scheduled visit of a couple weeks. There, my family doctor saw things differently. The ankle was severely broken in two places, and with an injury like that, I absolutely should not fly for at least 2 months. I was stranded back in the Bay Area with one working foot and no job. The prospect of 2 months sitting at home left me worried that I would lose the pulse of what was happening in China. I'd spent the last 6 months obsessively following and trying to contribute to news coverage of the country. Right before coming home, I had completed an intensive Mandarin program in which I vowed to speak no English for 3 months, a pledge that I broke at the exact same moment as my ankle. Now I was trapped in the leafy suburbs of the Bay Area, 6,000 miles from the action in Beijing. But then, the action started coming to me. At the time, prospective Chinese homebuyers were arriving in my hometown of Palo Alto in droves. They were boarding luxury buses for mobile real estate tours of the city, purchasing million-dollar homes the way my parents might snap up a nice piece of furniture. I called up the real estate agency hosting the tours and talked my way into joining one of them, eventually writing an article about it for the website of The Atlantic. The home-buying tours were a truly trans-Pacific phenomenon. The rush to move money out of China reflected jitters about that country's economy, and the sudden influx of rich Chinese buyers was ruffling feathers in California suburbs. It was one of the first signs I saw that the economic, social, and human narratives that I'd been tracing within China were now making their way onto American soil. When my ankle healed up, I headed back to China and resumed my job search. soon after arriving back in Beijing. A well-timed introduction and a lucky break landed me my dream job. As the first China correspondent for the World Post, a new media collaboration between the Huffington Post and the Berggruen Institute, a think tank. Before I could begin that work, I had to apply for a journalist visa. That application process is never easy, but my timing was particularly bad. A year earlier, the New York Times and Bloomberg had dropped bombshell investigations into the family wealth of China's top leadership, reports that led to a freeze on visas for those publications. Chinese leadership had no beef with the World Post, but we faced a different hurdle. China had never before granted full journalist credentials to an all-online media platform. The print-online distinction was functionally meaningless, but bureaucratically momentous. Tensions with the New York Times hung heavy over the Chinese Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and no one there was eager to hand out credentials to a new American outlet. I flew back to San Francisco in December of 2013, unsure if the powers that be would see fit to grant me the visa. But this time around, I was ready to track down some more Trans-Pacific narratives. When state labor inspectors raided the Southern California factory of a Chinese electric car company, I interviewed the eccentric mayor who had courted the company and covered the fallout from the investigation. I began visiting and interviewing people in the Hunters Point neighborhood being transformed by a Chinese-funded mega-development. I hung out with Chinese entrepreneurs in Silicon Valley and met the Airbnb team planning the company's China strategy. I even helped organize a delegation of small-town Bay Area mayors making a trip to China to pitch their cities as ideal destinations for investment. All these stories provided small windows into massive changes within China itself. When I first set foot in Beijing just 6 years earlier, China was still squarely a developing country. Awe-inspiring Olympic ceremony aside, it was a majority rural country whose economy ran on low-wage labor. China was considered a technological backwater and an afterthought for the U.S. entertainment industry. Cheap Chinese goods stocked the shelves of our nation's Walmarts, but that was about as close as Chinese people got to the everyday lives of most Americans. Now, as I followed these stories up and down the state of California, I saw early glimpses of a country transformed. Chinese technology companies had become some of the largest in the world, and they were making their presence felt in Silicon Valley. The Chinese movie industry was growing at breakneck speed and casting a spell over executives in Hollywood. Chinese students, tourists, investors, and homebuyers abroad were carving out a new reputation for their countrymen. Rich, sometimes cultured, sometimes crass, and very ready to spend. Watching as Chinese tourists lugging enormous cameras poured into Stanford's quad, I couldn't help but ask myself, is this how Italians in 1950s Rome felt when all the Americans began crowding into the Colosseum? This new wave of arrivals didn't quite reflect the life of the average Chinese person back home. The country was still middle income, with large swaths of the population scraping out a living in factories or on farms. And many Chinese immigrants arriving on U.S. soil did so in a low-key, thoughtful, and genuinely curious way. More in the tradition of James Baldwin in Paris than obnoxious Americans in Thailand. But China's growing footprint in California does offer clues into the country's future. The industries it wants to promote, the lifestyles it hopes to adopt, and the kind of wealth it hopes to cultivate. The Bay Area, Beijing, and back again. After 7 months in visa limbo, I was abruptly informed by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs that I would indeed receive a journalist visa. I tied up some loose ends with my reporting, packed my things, and in the late summer of 2014, headed back to Beijing. But sitting in the airport departures lounge, I once again knew that I would be coming back, this time to California. China still felt like the center of the action, but the Transpacific Experiment felt like the next frontier. Back in China with my newly minted journalist credentials, I pinballed around the country, covering everything from democracy protests in Hong Kong to down-and-out coal towns in Shaanxi province. I also traced the Trans-Pacific stories back to their source, meeting the Chinese students who were heading to California and those who had returned, the artificial intelligence AI researchers who left Google to found their startup back in China, and the wealthy birth tourists who gave birth to American citizens on U.S. soil before heading home to Beijing. In 2016, I moved to Ochlan, California, and since then I've continued weaving in more layers and more characters as these stories evolved. Tracing these trends from source to destination and back again continues to drive home the interconnectedness of these two places. In this world of deep China-U.S. entanglement, an anti-corruption crackdown in Guangzhou can drive up housing prices in Pasadena, and an ideological campaign in Beijing can reshape the movie slate of Hollywood studios. We don't know what long-term consequences these ties will yield, but it's clear that they are already molding the industries, technologies, universities, and communities that affect the entire world. Each of the following chapters charts these trends in one of six key arenas: education, technology, film, green investment, real estate, and American politics. Each chapter seeks to explore that arena through the eyes of the people who are living out these phenomena in real time: students, film producers, mayors, entrepreneurs, and community activists. Woven into those stories are my own intersections with them, the chances I've had to both observe and sometimes affect the Trans-Pacific Experiment in action. I've learned a tremendous amount about both countries from watching this strange new world take shape, and I hope you will as well. Let's dive in. 1. Freshman Orientation. Tim Lin has crystal-clear memories of the first time he woke up in an American dorm room. Tim was at Miami University in Ohio, nearly 7,000 miles east of his hometown in northwest China, and he was eager to get a jump on student life halfway around the world. But waking up early that morning, he got a different kind of education. Slumped across the bed of his roommate was a woman, fast asleep and completely naked. I was 17 years old. I had never seen a real naked girl. I'd seen something like that, but on the computer or on the TV, Tim recounted to me. He remembered thinking to himself, "Oh, so this is what it really is." From there, Tim was quickly inducted into the rites and rituals of collegiate America: Saturday football games, campus controversies, and tequila shots. Fast forward 3 years from Tim's 2012 graduation, and I'm watching blood rush to his head as he hangs upside down from a spine-stretching device at his startup's headquarters in Beijing. A couple of his employees look over with a mix of curiosity and concern as Tim's face turns a deep red. But he is at ease, calmly explaining to me the origins of his startup, College Daily. After graduating from Miami University in 2012, Tim spent a couple years bouncing between continents, working in Silicon Valley, volunteering in East Africa, and eventually landing back in China. That's when Tim created College Daily, a media company devoted entirely to the needs of Chinese students on foreign campuses. He began by writing articles explaining the things about American collegiate life that he wished he'd known during his undergrad years. What does it mean to get sexiled by your roommate? How can Chinese students enter the H-1B lottery for American work visas? And what is this Super Bowl that everyone is talking about? Tim began by posting the articles in a Chinese smartphone app called WeChat, and they quickly connected with a rapidly growing population of Chinese students in the United States. In the decade between when Tim enrolled at Miami University in 2008 and 2018, the number of Chinese students at American colleges had more than tripled from 98,000 to just over 360,000. California led all other states with over 60,000 Chinese students, nearly 50% more than second place New York. Along with College Daily's audience abroad, the startup also targets the millions of parents in China who have international ambitions for their child's education. That reach earned Tim venture capital funding, which he used to rent an office in a chic Beijing complex and hire a team of writers and editors. College Daily's readers are an advertiser's dream, united by a clear shared interest and predominantly wealthy. Chinese students of generations past often showed up on American soil with almost no money, just a dream of turning a technical PhD into a decent salary and an American green card. But today's Chinese students are a different breed. They are wealthier, younger, and far less invested in putting down roots in the United States. These traits often rub their classmates the wrong way, but it's the first of those qualifications that helped spur the boom in the first place. Following the financial crisis of 2008, American public colleges and universities saw their funding gutted. University administrators scoured the horizon for a way to replace the vanishing taxpayer support, and many of them settled on a quick fix: international students. While in-state students at public universities receive steep discounts, out-of-state or international students pay full tuition, often triple the amount of their local classmates. So schools threw open their gates to international students. The timing turned out to be impeccable. China's middle class was booming, and parents who had scratched their way up through an insanely competitive Chinese education system were hoping to spare their kids that same struggle. They hired English tutors, signed their kids up for SAT prep classes, and paid education consulting firms huge sums to guarantee entrance at American colleges. Once that acceptance letter came, the parents were happy to fork over the $35,000 a year for the privilege of an American university degree. China quickly came to dominate international student demographics, and by 2017, China accounted for 1 in 3 international students in the U.S. From the outside, it looked like a perfect match. American universities could patch holes in their budgets, and Chinese students could gain exposure to a top-flight international education. Beyond that financial exchange, there was also hope that these on-campus interactions could promote cultural understanding and even pull the world's two superpowers closer together. What better way is there to promote world peace than to have the future leaders of China and the United States chugging Bud Lights with one another? But on the ground, things weren't exactly playing out as imagined. University administrators may have seen Chinese students as a financial life jacket, but some California students observing changing campus demographics began to ask a new question. Are these foreign students subsidizing us, or just replacing us? The collegiate cultural melting pot also wasn't functioning as imagined. As the number of Chinese students grew, so too did the insularity of that group. Some Chinese students could get through 4 years at a UC school without truly mastering English or making more than a couple American friends. And in many cases, the politics of international campuses turned out to be more fraught than friendly. The Chinese government sometimes looked upon returning students with a wary eye, fearful that they brought with them the infectious disease of a desire for electoral democracy. American politicians turned out to share a mirror image of those suspicions. Media reports showing that the Chinese government helped fund some Chinese student groups led to fears that America was being infiltrated via its campuses. When those Chinese student groups organized campus protests against speakers they deemed offensive, such as the Dalai Lama, the question became whether the Chinese government was using these students to export its domestic restrictions on speech. By 2018, the backlash against Chinese students had gone from campus politics to national politics. Prominent senators and the FBI director were all piling on, accusing the students of acting as pawns and spies in a massive Chinese government scheme to steal technology and squash dissent. In private, President Trump remarked that almost every student that comes over to this country is a spy, and he entertained a proposal for placing an outright ban on student visas for Chinese citizens. This wasn't how the story of Chinese students in America was supposed to go. Missionaries and military technology. It's a story that has its origins as far back as the 1800s, when a smattering of Chinese students sailed across the Pacific to take up studies in the upstart nation known as Meiguo, Beautiful Country. But even these early international scholars were burdened by expectations both political and religious. Many early arrivals were sponsored by American Christian missionaries, who hoped that they would absorb that faith and return to China to spread it among their own people. The Chinese government had other ideas. In 1872, it sponsored what became known as the Chinese Educational Mission, a group of 120 boys who were sent to America to learn the art and science of American technology, particularly military technology. At the time, Imperial China was approaching an all-time low. Long confident that it possessed the most advanced civilization on Earth, China had been shaken from its slumber during the two Opium Wars of the mid-1800s, when European militaries armed with modern weaponry repeatedly steamrolled the Chinese forces. The devastating Taiping Rebellion and skirmishes with Western troops drove home the message. If China wanted to hold its own as an empire, it needed to learn these technologies from the West. Officials in the Qing dynasty approved the first batch of young Chinese men to be sent to the United States. But as those boys settled into life in New England, they began picking up more than just Western engineering concepts. Some converted to Christianity. Others earned thoroughly American nicknames like Ajax, Fighting Chinee, and Beijing's Johnny. The conservative Chinese official tasked with supervising the mission became alarmed that these boys were abandoning their Confucian culture and losing their loyalty to the Chinese emperor. Rubbing salt in that wound, the State Department refused to allow the Chinese students to enroll in West Point or other military academies, claiming there was no room available. After the students completed 9 of the planned 15 years, Chinese officials canceled the mission and ordered the boys back to China, where they were detained and thoroughly interrogated on arrival. Several boys from that group would go on to take up leadership positions in the Chinese military and bureaucracy, but they couldn't reverse the rot of the Qing dynasty, which continued to wrestle with a love-hate relationship with the technology and culture of the West. A year after the boys' 1881 departure from the beautiful country, the United States passed the Chinese Exclusion Act. It would be nearly 100 years before the Chinese government would send another large batch of students to learn from America. Second Wave Scholars. That next group of students made the journey at another low point for China. The year was 1978, and the country was still in a daze from the madness of Mao Zedong's Great Proletarian Cultural Revolution, 1966-76. During that decade, China's education systems were largely crippled by fanatical student Red Guards who tormented their teachers for teaching anything feudal, traditional, Confucian, or foreign, most modern academic and scientific knowledge that didn't adhere to Mao Zedong thought. The government sent scholars of math and science to work in coal mines and eventually dispersed the Red Guards to the Chinese countryside to learn from the peasant farmers. By the time the dust settled on the Cultural Revolution, China was decades behind the West in most fields of modern science and technology. Eager to make up lost ground, China's new leader, Deng Xiaoping, struck a deal with U.S. President Jimmy Carter to send a cohort of 52 Chinese scholars to study at a handful of American universities. They were to spend a few years immersed in fields such as computer science and return to China to plant the seeds of the country's technological rebirth. when the first batch of 12 scholars arrived at Princeton University, Professor Stanley Kwong was there to greet them. An assistant dean at Princeton, Professor Kwong had grown up between Hong Kong and the United States and had visited China in 1973 as part of an early delegation of Chinese-American students and scholars. On that trip, Chinese Premier Zhou Enlai had personally asked him to help take care of Chinese students in the United States. They needed the help. The students may have had the backing of the central government, but at the time, China's per capita GDP was on par with Rwanda's. The scholars were kept on a tight financial leash. They ended up having white bread for breakfast and white bread for lunch, Professor Kwong recalled. To boost those nutrients, he and some other Chinese-American professors would get together once a month to cook a big chicken dinner for the students. After a few years of work and study in the U.S., those scholars returned to China and took up leading posts in Chinese academia, heading up university departments and laying the foundations in new fields of study. They were soon followed by a new kind of Chinese student, those who came to America on their own. By the mid-1980s, a steady trickle of these young Chinese began arriving in the United States. Many relied on relatives in the United States to sponsor their visas by pledging to financially support the students. But those relatives were often barely scraping out a living in Chinatown restaurants or garment factories, and the new students had to fend for themselves financially. That meant pairing full-time studies with hard work, often as waiters in restaurants or manual laborers in factories or warehouses. Work restrictions on student visas meant much of that labor had to be done in Chinatown's under-the-table cash economy. Earlier waves of immigrants who now ran these businesses used the students' precarious legal position as bargaining leverage, often paying them as little as half of minimum wage. Whatever they could squeeze, they squeezed, one student-turned-immigrant in San Francisco told me. For these students, the payoff, a shot at a United States green card, was worth the struggle. China was steadily turning itself into a manufacturing powerhouse, but the economic gap between it and the United States remained enormous. In terms of quality of life, it was still better to be relatively poor in America than middle class in China. Once these students got a hold of life in America, they didn't want to let go. Budget cuts and international booms. What a difference a generation makes. By 2008, three decades of breakneck economic growth had produced a large cohort of very wealthy Chinese parents, factory owners, real estate developers, technology entrepreneurs, and government officials who could skim off all these industries. Having a child studying abroad became a status symbol in these circles, and Chinese applications to American colleges skyrocketed. They found a very receptive audience in the admissions offices of American public universities. Public funding for higher education has been shrinking for several decades, but during the financial crisis of 2008, that steady decline turned into a sudden plunge. California was a prime example of the trend. Between 2007 and 2012, California's state support for public higher education, including the UC system and the parallel California State University system, dropped by $2 billion, a cut of over 30%. School administrators scrambled to make up the difference, but lawmakers proved indifferent to their pleas, and any attempt to raise tuition was met with protests. Henry Brady, dean of UC Berkeley's Goldman School of Public Policy, described the dilemma facing these schools. You've got a budget constraint, costs are going up, state funding is going down or staying steady, and you're not allowed to increase tuition, Brady told the San Francisco Chronicle. We're producing a Cadillac education for the cost of a Chevy, and the state's saying you should do it at a motorcycle price. At some point, you have to ask, what's realistic? With their backs up against the financial wall, public universities quickly began ramping up out-of-state and international student enrollment. The logic is straightforward. These students often pay around triple the tuition of local students and generally receive no financial aid. During the 2014-15 school year, local undergraduate students at UC Berkeley paid roughly $13,328 in tuition, with 55% of those local students qualifying as low income and thus paying no tuition at all. Their out-of-state and international classmates put down $36,833 for the same education and were generally excluded from public financial aid. Theoretically, every Chinese student who enrolled could effectively subsidize the tuition of two of her California classmates. The stage was set for the great Chinese student boom. Between 2008 and 2012, Chinese enrollment in U.S. colleges and universities grew by over 20% every year, according to the Institute for International Education. By 2013, total Chinese enrollment was more than triple the levels before the 2008 financial crisis, and during the 2017-18 school year, China set a record with over 360,000 undergraduate and graduate students. The country had vaulted past India as the top source of international students in the United States, and by 2017 accounted for more students in the U.S. than the next five countries combined. Big state schools, many of them in the Midwest, absorbed the largest number of Chinese students. The University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign emerged as the unlikely leader in total Chinese enrollment. The school went from hosting just 37 Chinese undergraduates in the year 2000 to enrolling nearly 3,000 by 2014. Flagship public campuses in Wisconsin, Indiana, and Ohio all followed the same pattern, throwing open their doors to students from across the Pacific. But at a statewide level, California led the nation with more than 60,000 students from the People's Republic. Between 2007 and 2017, Chinese enrollment at the 10 campuses of the University of California system, UC Berkeley, UCLA, etc., multiplied by a factor of nearly 10. At the start of the 2017-18 school year, 22,325 Chinese students were enrolled across the UC campuses, more than double the number of African American students in the system. Ferraris and Chinese takeout. And when these students arrived, many of them did so in style. Professor Stanley Kwong had a front-row seat to the changing demographics of Chinese students. After greeting those first Chinese students at Princeton in 1978, Professor Kwong had spent the intervening 30 years as a global marketing executive for IBM. Following his retirement from IBM in 2009, he returned to academia as a professor at the University of San Francisco, USF, a private Jesuit school near the center of the city. Professor Kwong was beginning to see more and more Chinese students in his marketing classes, but it was their after-hours activities that attracted the most attention. At the time, Professor Kwong frequently appeared as a guest on local Cantonese radio stations, discussing Chinese economics and politics. Many of his listeners lived in the Richmond neighborhood abutting USF, a quiet part of town home to many elderly immigrants from Hong Kong and Taiwan. Beginning around 2013, Professor Kwong started to get more callers in his radio programs complaining about one thing: the sound of Ferrari engines at night. As students from mainland China increased at USF, Chinese restaurants in Richmond began adapting to the new patrons, swapping out Cantonese seafood dishes for the spice of Sichuan cuisine. They also expanded their hours, with some staying open until 3 a.m. to catch the students returning from a night of karaoke. The bustle of normal business was one thing for elderly neighbors, but these late-night crews often announced their presence by gunning their engines. If a Ferrari is driving in your neighborhood, Professor Kwong told me, you notice that because of the roar, right? Chinese students were by no means universally rich. Many middle-class Chinese parents had worked hard and saved up for decades to give their kids a chance to study in America. Some of those students spent 2 years at American community colleges, often working side jobs on nights and weekends, for the chance to transfer to a place like UCLA. Even among students from wealthy backgrounds, most opted to keep a low profile and blend in on campus. For many of their families, a diploma from a top U.S. college stood right at the intersection of an up-by-your-bootstraps American dream and deeply held Confucian values about the paramount importance of education. But the Ferrari-driving cohort were the most noticeable to outsiders, in part because of how different they appeared from the humble PhDs of generations past. Tim Lin had arrived in America just as the transition got underway, and College Daily documented the shifting profile of Chinese students on American campuses. 10 years ago, nobody bought Mercedes, BMW, or luxury brands, Tim Lin told me on my first visit to his office headquarters. They bought second, third, or even fourth-hand 1995 Toyota Corollas. But right now, it's 2015. We see a lot of students fly first class to the U.S. When they arrive in the U.S., they've already bought the luxury car. They ask the students who are already there to buy the car first and just give them the car at the airport. Should I stay or should I go? It wasn't just money that separated these Chinese students from their predecessors. They were also younger, less academically elite, and far less likely to stay in the U.S. long term. From the 1980s through the early 2000s, very few Chinese students enrolled in U.S. undergraduate programs. Instead, the vast majority of Chinese students at American universities were pursuing graduate studies, often PhDs in technical fields. These scholars represented the cream of the academic crop in China, products of prestigious institutions like Tsinghua or Peking University, with a track record of excellence that gained them entrance to top American research programs. And when this group earned their degrees, they almost always stayed to work in the country. One study by the National Science Foundation showed that of Chinese students who had earned PhDs in the United States from 2002 to 2004, 86% of them were still in America a decade after graduating. That retention rate was tied with India for the highest of any country, and nearly triple the 32% stay rate of South Korean doctoral recipients. But after 2008, all of these markers began to shift. More Chinese high school students began applying directly to U.S. colleges. They were not necessarily the highest performing students at their schools, but rather students who could afford to enroll in international high school programs. In 2011, the number of Chinese undergrads in the UC system surpassed the number of graduate students for the first time, with that milestone replicated at the national level a couple years later. Within a few years of earning a bachelor's degree, many of these students returned to China. Chinese people who study abroad and then return to China are known as haigui, a pun on the Chinese word for sea turtle that means to return from overseas. During earlier waves of overseas study in the 1980s and 1990s, sea turtles were a rare breed, and when they returned home, they were often rewarded with coveted positions in universities or multinational corporations. But as the number of students going abroad multiplied, so too did the number of sea turtles. There isn't comprehensive data on return rates among more recent arrivals, but a mix of statistical indicators and anecdotal evidence points to a sea change in decisions about whether to stay. In 2017, a record-setting 480,000 students returned to China after studying abroad. China's Ministry of Education estimated in 2016 that return rates had risen to 70 to 80% beginning around 2013. Those numbers were approximately in line with the results of a survey on the post-graduation plans of Chinese students at Purdue University in Indiana. 57% planned to return to China after a few years in the U.S., while 9% wanted to return to China immediately, and 13% hoped to stay in the U.S. indefinitely. 21% said they didn't know. Those shifting return rates reflect both a push away from the U.S. and a pull back to China. A main factor pushing students to return is the increasing difficulty in obtaining H-1B visas, the most common visa for high-skill foreign citizens who have found a job in the United States. The United States caps the number of new H-1B visas each year, entering all applicants into a lottery that picks the lucky winners. Recent years have seen a steady rise in applications, while the 85,000 visa cap has remained unchanged. That means Chinese graduates who found jobs in the U.S. have seen their odds of winning the lottery to obtain a visa steadily fall. But that push to return to China isn't always as blunt as a visa rejection. When I graduated from college, I believed in American dreams. I can get a good living, a good future in America. We follow the rules and blah, 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 Tim Lin told me. But when we start to work, we realize there is a glass ceiling for Chinese students. Tim bumped up against that glass in his first job out of college, at an accounting firm in San Jose, California. What initially looked like a promising gig quickly fizzled over cultural barriers. Tim felt lost during Sunday football parties with the firm's partners, and what he saw at management levels told him the deck was stacked against Chinese and other Asians when it came to promotions. Earlier generations of Chinese graduates often had to swallow their pride and stick with these jobs. Their H-1B visa and chance of obtaining a U.S. green card depended on it. But China's economic transformation and the wealthier family background of many of these students have changed that calculus. An American degree is no longer the golden ticket out of an impoverished country. For many of these students, especially those who are heirs to a successful family business, their earning potential is higher in their home country. That reversal of fortunes is changing the way these students...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.